Thank you ever so much, and a very warm welcome here to St James's Piccadilly. It's lovely to see you all here so close to Christmas itself. I'm delighted to be music director of London Oriana Choir. My name's Dominic Ellis Peckham, and this is certainly my favourite time of year from a musical perspective, because there's just such a wealth of music on offer. And might I say, by the way, you sound absolutely fantastic yourselves. Auditions are in January. We are very full here this evening, but we're also full of beady-eyed watchers from across the globe, as this concert is being streamed right now live on YouTube, and I believe will be available for a short time afterwards if you want to share with friends and family who might not be in this country or able to join us. We have had a wonderful year, really, really jubilant celebrations of just simply being back together. It's been a very difficult few years in terms of wanting to celebrate this beautiful music. It's been an incredibly thought-provoking time. Many people have had their lives changed forever because of what we've all been through as a world. But we cannot believe that we are back, able to enjoy our music making and our singing with you. So we are so grateful and so, so honoured that you've chosen to join us this evening on Tuesday the 20th. Let me just work this out. Strictly has finished, World Cup has finished, so there's no real excuse for you not to be here. So I guess I shouldn't be that grateful. We are going to carry on this evening. You can see at the end of the first half, we're celebrating the music of the wonderful Benjamin Britten with a ceremony of carols with our guest harpist as well. You just heard an arrangement by Philip Ledger, the wonderful director of music and organist of the Sussex Carol. We now move on to a piece lesser known, but by a composer you will certainly have heard of, that of Tchaikovsky and the Crown of Roses.
Thank you.
Well, as you can tell, we're having a lot of fun this evening. There is so much music, there is so much unheard music yet, and as you keep hearing me go on about over the years, if you are a regular attendee at our concerts, you know that one of the most important parts, certainly of the last 5 to 7 years of our existence, has been the work we've done in our project, our initiative called 515, where we commissioned 15 brand new pieces by 5 composers who just happened to identify as women. We wanted to be part of something that had even more of a legacy than this choir's history had already. We wanted to give something back, and so 515 was born. It's now completed. There was a small hiatus, something to do with a global pandemic in the middle. But there were 10 pieces a cappella and 5 with accompaniment, 5 with some form of orchestral accompaniment that paired with pieces like Vivaldi's Gloria or the Monteverdi Vespers, things like that we were already programming. And it was born out of a realization that actually, if you look at major, and I do mean major, Christmas musical performances that might be televised, that might happen close to Christmas, perhaps on Christmas morning or Christmas Eve evening. I'm not going to name the names, but I'm pretty sure you know what I'm talking about. It was alarming, truly disgusting to see how much inequality, how much lack of diversity there was. If we want to change something in this world, then surely there needs to be people as an example. Surely there needs to be leaders being allowed to do what they do in order to inspire people who are underrepresented. And that is exactly what 515 was trying to do, to highlight the work of women composers. I'm now delighted that at the end of 22, I'm literally going to stop using the word women. And I'm just going to say composers, because thankfully, many other organizations, many other institutions have followed suit and are really thinking about their programming. There is a lot more to do. There is so much more inequality when it comes to music, when it comes to stage work, creativity of all kinds. And we're doing our best, but there's a lot more to do. And we're delighted to be part of Key Change, which is making an effort to provide equality both on and off stage with the directors, with the designers, with the composers, with the performers, stagehands, everything. If you are looking at a stage and there isn't an example of where you come from, where you hail from, who you are, then you need to shout about it, or we need to shout about it for you. And so 515 has been one of the most important things I've ever been involved in. And you can see a diverse program this evening, and indeed, O Oriens, which took place just before the second congregational carol there, was by the great Cecilia McDowall, who since being part of the initiative has been honoured, or we have been honoured, that she has become our patron. Much more to come. Thank you for a little town of Bethlehem. We now go to someone who needs no introduction. This is a piece called Lux Aurumque. Thank you.
old regular officer with the 1st Division North Staffs, wrote to his wife on Christmas Eve, 1914, from the trenches in northern France. I have just been through one of the most extraordinary scenes imaginable. Tonight is Christmas Eve, and I came up into the trenches this evening for my tour of duty in them. Firing was going on all the time, and the enemy's machine guns were at it hard, firing at us. Then, about 7, the firing stopped. I was in my dugout, reading a paper, and the mail was being dished out. It was reported that the Germans had lighted their trenches up all along our front. We had been calling to one another for some time, Christmas wishes and other things. I went out and they shouted, "No shooting!" And then, somehow, the scene became a peaceful one. All our men got out of the trenches and sat on the parapet. The Germans did the same. And they talked to one another in English and broken English. I got on top of the trench and talked German and asked them to sing a German Volkslied, which they did. Then our men sang and each side clapped and cheered the other. I asked a German who sang a solo to sing one of Schumann's songs. So he sang The Two Grenadiers splendidly. Our men were a good audience and really enjoyed his singing. Then Pope and I walked across and held a conversation with the German officer in command. One of his men introduced us properly. He asked my name and then presented me to his officer. I gave the latter permission to bury some German dead who were lying in between us, and we agreed to have no shooting until 12 midnight tomorrow. We talked together. 10 or more Germans gathered round. I was almost in their lines, within a yard or so. We saluted each other. He thanked me for permission to bury his dead, and we fixed up how many men were to do it, and that otherwise both sides must remain in their trenches. Then we wished one another good night and a good night's rest and a happy Christmas and parted with a salute. I got back to the trench. The Germans sang Die Wacht am Rhein. It sounded well. Then our men sang quite well, Christians Awake. And with a good night, we all got back into our trenches. It was a curious scene, a lovely moonlit night. The German trenches with small lights on them and the men on both sides gathered in groups on the parapets. I allowed one or two men to go out and meet a German or two halfway. They exchanged cigars, a smoke, and talked. The officer I spoke to hopes we shall do the same on New Year's Day. I said, yes, if I'm here. It is weird to think that tomorrow night we shall be at it again. If one gets through this show, it will be a Christmas time to live in one's memory. The German who sang had a really fine voice.
Thank you.
Well, you've heard lots of maybe music you haven't heard of this evening, I wonder. Certainly that of the wonderful Rebecca McGlade. And we look forward to some other interesting new pieces in the second half. But now we turn to something which is indeed exceptionally familiar to so many of you. The wonderful work of Benjamin Britten, one of my heroes. I had the pressure, and I do mean pressure rather than pleasure, of conducting in front of his family, his relatives, though who still exist. I work a lot up in Snape Maltings, his home, a centre for such creative excellence from across the world, and such an honour to be part of it. Britten writes so wonderfully for voices, writes so wonderfully for orchestra, and of course his operas are exceptionally important. Still, I believe he's underrated, if that can be possible. But when it comes to Christmas, there is so much beautiful music which he gave us. And indeed, this setting for upper voices and harp is ever so special. Please welcome our guest harpist, Cecily Beer, and the upper voices for Benjamin Britten's Ceremony of Carols.
Follow me now. the good will of the people. And the angel said unto them, Do not be afraid. I bring you news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the city of David, a Saviour has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. And a shepherd said unto the angel, Hold it right there, chum. And the angel did hold it right there. And the shepherd said, In the current political climate, you can't seriously expect that any proposal will cause great joy for all the people. And the angel said, Well. But the shepherd continued, as his question had in fact been rhetorical. We've been debating the options, and even among this small and barely representative cross-section of the Jewish agricultural working class, there is a wide and apparently unbridgeable range of opinions as to the way forward to a solution in the search for an acceptable Messiah. And the angel said, Go on. And the shepherd pointed at his three colleagues. Jacob, here is a zealot, all for us going it alone. Tell the Romans exactly where to put their empire. The Samaritans and the Greeks, they can go home too. He wants not just immigration reduced, but Israel wholly rejuiced. Joanna, on the other hand, she's a Rome-aner. She thinks there are several things that the Romans have, in fact, done for us. Jeremiah, he's a social activist. No surrendering unto Caesar. He proposes an end to Augustus Arete. And the scandal of babies having to sleep in feeding troughs wrapped in second-hand clothing. Me, I think we need to remember who it was that sorted out Egypt and the Philistines. Moses and King David, that's my kind of good shepherd. Good on our side, and a proper price for a sacrificial lamb. Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, arguing among themselves about the merits of purgatory as a time-limited backstop for salvation. And the angel said again loudly, Today is the city of David is born for you a Messiah. He is the Messiah, the Lord. And the shepherd said, You're surely not going to say he's the only possible Messiah. To please all of this lot, you'd need to be a peaceful revolutionary agitator who sets families against one another, believes we're the chosen people, but treats Romans and Samaritans equally, pays taxes, but won't accept the judgments of the courts, stands up for adulterers, pimps, scroungers, and leopards, resists all political compromise, and relentlessly attacks those in power for greed, pride, and self-seeking hypocrisy. Anyone who did all that would be crucified. And the angel said unto them, You will find the baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger.
Thank you.
Sometimes the simplest things are the most effective, and that piece by the amazing Erilyn Wallen, of course, as you could tell, was just one simple unison line. And we're so honoured to have such wonderful soloists within the choir, but also we're really delighted to be joined by two amazing, amazing musicians who've been with us for both of these performances. So please show your appreciation, firstly to our soloists, but also to our guest harpist, Cecily Beer, and the amazing organist, Andrew Tate. That piece, perhaps more than anything else, really does ask for absolute silence. You can really hear a pin drop. And let me tell you, we're delighted that you can. Because our first concert happened to coincide with some form of street party outside during the rehearsal, which finished at 6 o'clock, and we could just about deal with that. But we thought, it's fine, we'll have lovely silence come once in Royal David City. And at about 7:25, when we were lining up for the beginning of the performance, Morocco beat Portugal? I have no idea, but the whole of Piccadilly came to a standstill. We had fireworks fired at the church. There were horns and screaming and odd ways to celebrate, if you ask me. So we had to really turn on our listening ears, but we're delighted that we have some peace on earth for this performance. This next piece is by the contemporary British composer, Will Todd. My Lord Has Come.
Thank you. Festive to speak about their charity this evening, so I've been asked to say a few words on their behalf. St. Mungo's is one of the UK's leading homelessness charities. Its ambition is to reverse the rise in rough sleeping across the country and to at least halve the number of people who sleep rough in the areas where they work. St. Mungo's vision is that everyone has a place to call home and can fulfill their hopes and ambitions. In 1969, a group of people decided to do something to help the people they saw sleeping rough on the streets of London. They started by going out, talking to people, offering food and what assistance they could. From there, they managed to secure their first hostel to accommodate people sleeping rough, a former Marmite factory in Vauxhall, South London. In the years since, St. Mungo's has continued working to end homelessness and has been on the front line of delivering services to keep people healthy, housed, and hopeful. St. Mungo's works with a client-led recovery approach. This means that St. Mungo's staff build on the strengths of their clients and use those skills and interests as the basis for recovery. St. Mungo's services can be broken down into three main areas. Firstly, emergency projects, such as its street outreach teams. Outreach teams go out at night and in the early mornings looking for people sleeping rough. Their first priority is to get people off the streets and into accommodation. Secondly, St. Mungo's operates a range of accommodation services, from basic shelters or hostels through to supported and semi-independent housing, to help people at every stage of their recovery from homelessness. Alongside having somewhere safe and secure to stay, staff and volunteers work with their clients to understand their hopes and ambitions, helping them take the steps they need to achieve them. Finally, St. Mungo's has recovery projects to build clients' skills and support them into employment. This includes horticultural therapy, skills training such as construction skills, as well as emotional support. St. Mungo's believes that when given the right support, people can and do recover from homelessness. St. Mungo's is very grateful to the London Oriana Choir for supporting their work through a retiring collection at tonight's concert. With your support, St. Mungo's can make sure more people have their last night on the streets and their first night of a new life. Please give generously to the buckets on your way out. Thank you.
we are so grateful that you've been part of this evening, and we're so honoured to have performed two concerts here over the last 10 days. We know that Christmas means so many different things to so many people, but we do hope that you're heading towards Christmas Day with some happiness and with some peace and with some togetherness. And we all are indeed very much looking forward to a more peaceful, a safer, a more prosperous new year. There are so many parts of this world where Christmas Day is just another day, and where perhaps indeed over the last 12 months life has changed for the worse. Life has changed and is no longer as they know it. But we are so grateful that you're here. We know that we are grateful to be together. And we hope that you're looking forward to a positive and prosperous 23 and hopefully a lovely, lovely Christmas. And on that note, can we be the very first to wish you a very happy Christmas.